prominent historical Arabic television series. And there was a very moving scene where Abdurrahman al-Dakhil was standing by the river of Efrat while witnessing on the other bank of the river the murder of his younger brother by the Abbasid, and he cried loud. After the series was shown on television, I met a highly educated friend of mine who congratulated me for the success of this series. But he had one objection that he couldn't accept, and it was seeing Abdurrahman al-Dakhil cry. When I asked him why, he replied, because he's a hero. I said, but he's a human being. He said, regardless of that, he is a hero, and heroes don't cry. Then I began asking myself, why some of us do not want to see our heroes cry? And consequently, how we perceive history and all its stories and characters and ups and downs. Since the 16th till now, historical drama has been one of the main genres of the Arabic television drama production. Egypt as well as Syria have always been the pioneers in this field, and centers from which these productions have propagated to the rest of the Arabic world. The period from the 17th until now, until the end of the 20th century, witnessed the flourishing of the Egyptian television historical drama production. Yet, with the start of this 21st century, it obviously began to retreat. Meanwhile, the Syrian television historical drama production has stepped forward to take the lead throughout the past decade, surpassing its Egyptian counterpart with its much more dramatic and cinematic vision, a vision which constitutes depth, precision, and research when it comes to content, and realistic visual vision of various historical settings when it comes to form. History, with all its stories and characters, still remain one of the hardest and most sensitive topics to touch upon in any Arabic cultural discussion. The reason behind this is that to us, Arab history is not just part of yesterday. It's on the contrary, present in our everyday life and cultural discussions with a variety of interpretation and explanation of each of its stories and characters. Not only do these stories and characters affect our present, but in fact, they shape this present differently according to our various point of view and multiple adapted readings of this history. Hence, we find it extremely strange when Western media portrays us as one homogeneous Arabic and Islamic world regarding the rest of the world. With the same constant vision throughout the past and present, we actually think that such portrayal is silly, not to mention superficial, as it lacks knowledge and precision. It's just like a satellite taking picture, which gives you the general outlook, yet it lacks details. On the contrary, when it comes to our vision of an interpretation of our past, present, and relationship with the other, we are different. Even as Muslims, we have various interpretations of our religion, a variety that caused a lot of conflicts. Some of them were merely intellectual and philosophical, while others were not. For example, back in the 19th century Damascus, Sheikh Ahmad al-Khalil Qabbani established the Arabic musical theater through working extensively on blending historical stories with the art of acting, singing, and dancing. Not only to entertain, but also to enlighten his audience. Meanwhile, another sheikh called Sa'id al-Ghabra attacked al-Qabbani works, saying that it was sinful and therefore religiously forbidden. His pretext was that it distracted people from worshipping God and opened their mind on a lot of questions which could lead them to skepticism or to what is worse, blasphemy. Moreover, Al-Ghabra went on saying that making men act women's role was a heinous violation of the nature that God created us on. Strange enough, when Al-Kabbani was able to convince two ladies to act in his place, Al-Ghabra came out with a petition to Sultan Abdul Hamid in which he expressed his fury against what he called opening adolescents' eyes on the feeling of love and desire, and so leading to the spread of violence. This is one of thousands of examples of conflicts in which two men of religion stood with their devotees face to face, with their contradicting points of view regarding cultural issues related to religion. It's true that both of them were Muslims, but they differed greatly in their interpretation of Islam and interpretation upon which they based their stance and acceptance or refusal of the art of theater. There is even more to it. As many people do not know that Al-Kabbani associate in his theatrical experimentations was a Christian man called Skander Farah. Al-Kabbani and Farah used to commence the rehearsal in Damascus 19th century by saying, "In the name of God, the merciful and the beneficent, and in the holy name of Mary," respectively. Despite the burning of his theater, Al-Kabbani immigrated with his associate Farah to Egypt, another Arab and Muslim country, and went on with his flourishing theatrical experimentations for 17 years. I guess it's obvious now that the Arab scene is much deeper and variegated than the way it's depicted in the Western media. This depiction is done sometimes out of lazy yet unintentional indifferences, while at other times out of intentional malice. Nowadays, there are a lot of theaters, actors, directors, and producers all over the Arab world, like many others all over. Some of them produce trivial and superficial works, while others present deep and controversial works tackling various important political and social issues. These works, especially television ones, became the subject of wide-range media coverage and discussion, and have a great effect on the Arab public, who tend to attain knowledge through watching television rather than reading the books. Here comes the importance of historical television drama, which occupies a special status in the production and showtime plans, and raises a lot of arguments. To understand the reason behind that, one has to make a quick overall comparison between the Arab nation present and past. Today, most of us Arabs feel that we are victims of injustice and prejudice, and that our dignity is being trampled over. Much of the world does not perceive us fairly and objectively. Instead, it perceives us as retarded human beings living on land, either floating on oil or is a strategic location for occupational control of resources or roads leading to them. For centuries, English, French, Italian, Spanish, and many other military troops and fleets have been coming and going on the Arab soil. They all competed with each other, not only to colonize land, but also on turning Arab civilians into troops fighting in wars that had nothing to do with them. They even left thousands of their minefields planted in Arab deserts since the First and the Second World War. In addition to all of this, there is ultimate sympathy shown by the West towards Israel, which has defeated the Arabs more than once, and as a result of that, replaced one people, the Palestinians, with another, the Israelis.